The Guy, Sharyn and Clint podcast.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Guy, Sharyn and Clint podcast. Today, we're going to try something different for the introduction.
Do you hear that?
It's good. It's something that Guy and I came up with just after you left yesterday, Sharyn. It's called.
Doesn't sound like it's going to be very good then, if I didn't come up with it.
It's called the Conversation Cyclone.
There's the sound of the cyclone in the distance.
It's good now because I did that sound.
How this works is we chuck one word or one idea
jelly
into the cyclone and just see where the conversation blows.
Okay, I would like to chuck the first word in.
Okay, you've already chucked in jelly. You
can
take that back.
Okay, no, we'll do jelly.
No. What was the one you had planned?
No, I would like to do jelly. That's
okay,
good.
Go for it.
My mum used to make two-toned jelly for me and my sisters when we went to school. She would make the jelly and put it in one half of the Ezio container, put it in the fridge, and then when it was hard, she'd like put the next flavour on top. It's pretty good.
So
used to trade it at school.
Yeah. You traded at school?
Yeah.
What would you trade it for?
A roll-up.
Trade it for a roll-up?
Yep.
But did it come?
That was before Uncle Toby stole my idea of rainbow roll-ups, which I invented.
Uncle Toby stole your idea?
On tomorrow's show, up Uncle Toby.
No, I've written them multiple letters. I have. Friend Catherine.
Can we get your letters and we'll call it Uncle Toby's tomorrow?
No, because I sent them to Uncle Toby's. How are they going to respond to my letters if I held on to them?
Uncle Toby. So tomorrow we'll call him up and ask about the letters, okay?
Okay.
When you were trading the jelly.
Yeah. Also, I used to trade chicken sandwiches. I made a great living out of chicken sandwiches.
Yeah, but if you were trading jelly and it was homemade, surely it came in like a Tupperware container that your mum wanted back?
Yeah, part of the condition. I had to get the container back.
So they had to sit there and eat the jelly in front of you?
No, we're in the same class. I was like, make sure you give me my container back or there'll be no jelly for you tomorrow.
What was your container retention like?
What do you mean?
How often did you get your containers back?
All the time. I was intimidating.
When you're giving out jelly containers to people, you've got to be threatening. That's the rule.
I wasn't actually intimidating, but it's hard to believe. I'm a bit naggy. And I just like, you got my container? You finished my container? I'm going to take it home to mum. Then we no more jelly tomorrow. Oh, for fuck's sake, Savaloy.
I'm going to be honest with you.
Savaloy, you will get your jelly container back when we're ready.
Homemade jelly for a roll-up, that's a good trade. Because if I remember primary school well, it's that the highest form of currency was always a roll-up.
Yeah.
No, or fruit for yonks.
Fruit for yonks. Who could forget?
Oh, Jesus. What about when they printed the fruit for yonks?
Yep, that was good. Do you want a fun fact about fruit for yonks?
Yeah.
Yes.
They always claimed that they were a metre long, but they were actually only 95 centimetres.
And is that Uncle Toby again?
Oh, I don't want to.
That motherfucker.
I don't want to name names, but.
Bloody, dirty old Uncle Toby. Always coming to the Christmas parties and ruining them. Always wrecking your fruit for yonks.
It's true. Oh, I used to sell chicken rolls at high school.
You're taking this conversation some weird places.
My mum used to make me 6 little chicken rolls. I'd take them to school. I'd sell them for $2. And
what?
I would make.
Did she make them for you to sell?
No, she didn't know for ages.
Then why was she making you 6 chicken rolls?
Because I used to get bus sick, so I couldn't eat breakfast before I went. So I had 2 for breakfast, 2 for interval, and 2 for lunch.
She had chicken rolls.
This is the Sharyn schoolyard story right here. The time I used to have 6 chicken rolls.
No, the conversation cyclone has taken us to some weird places.
I sold them to 6 different people.
Ended on Sharyn racketeering with chicken rolls.
That was a great conversation cyclone.
I'm a businesswoman.
Coming up in the show today, we have Adam from Mythbusters. That's pretty mind-blowing. He also does Uber Facts.
Yes.
We have Guy's Auntie Trish. We have Sharyn's relationship role reversal. That's kind of awkward. A lot of relationship problems from Sharyn in today's show.
And we give away some money for some very cool things as well.
Awesome.
Check it out.
Guy, Sharyn and Clint on the edge.
Guys. I've got to do this in my man voice because it was a real role reversal in our house last night.
Okay.
Last night, guys, I was on the couch just watching Craigo's World because I love sports. Rugby, tits, beer.
What's your man name?
According to BuzzFeed today, my elderly name would be Earl,
okay,
so
Earl.
I'm going to go with Earl.
Earl.
I was on the couch last night, guys, and I was watching the crowd goes wild because I love rugby and sports and they've got hot tricks on there sometimes. And then all of a sudden, the bloody husband's down the hall, pipes up from the hot water cupboard, and he goes, Sharyn, I wish you'd just do more. He's being a woman, by the way.
Okay.
I wish you'd just do more washing. Like, I just do never-ending amounts of laundry, and I'm always putting it out. This stuff here, it's been there for a week. Oh, for goodness sake, I'll do it in the morning. I've got the whole morning for it. I've been quite busy. It's just, we're all busy. But you just need to help out with the washing, okay? Because I'm cooking the dinner. I can't do the washing as well, you know? Like, there's all this stuff. And this load, pretty much all yours. And I'm here hanging it out.
And this is Bryce.
Yep.
Bryce from The Rock.
Yep, my husband. And I said, I was looked at him and I said, well, all I do is scoot it over here and I'll fold it up while I watch the sports news. And he turned around and he goes, just don't even bother, I've done it now. And he walks off and puts it down on the step and he goes, just when you go upstairs this time, can you take it upstairs instead of letting it sit there for 3 days getting in the way? Got the cleaner coming on Tuesday. And I just thought to myself, A, first of all, well-trained, does my washing and cooks my dinner. Obviously, I'm doing something right. But isn't that a role reversal? Usually it would be the female that's like, oh, mate, can you help me do the washing over here?
So I feel like you've still got your man voice on.
The next morning, I did end up doing a whole lot of washing, and I said to him,
good, so you should.
And I said, hey, did you notice I did all that washing, babe? And he's like, yes, I really appreciated it, babes. And I'm back in the good book, so yeah, guys, gonna get some tonight. But we want to talk about this afternoon, the role reversals in your relationships, whether it's the manly things that your female partner does, or is it the girly things that your man does? So tell us, 0800 The Edge, or text us to 3343.
I'm a terrible driver, so pretty much every girlfriend I've had has been better, has like worn the pants, and like, should I drive, should I? Because you can't park.
Are you always the passenger?
I'm normally the passenger.
That's very emasculating.
I hate driving. You can text when you're in the passenger seat.
And you get to change the radio stations.
Yes.
Mm. Okay, all right.
You wouldn't need to do that because you're always on the edge.
0800 The Edge. Yeah, true. 0800 The Edge.
I've got 5 different presets of The Edge, so sometimes I'm like, The Edge. I'm like, oh, I wonder what this sounds like on preset 4. So I'll just switch to preset 4.
Are you telling me there's other radio stations than The Edge?
I thought this was the only radio station.
Yeah, there's the only one that there is.
No other good ones.
But we're getting off topic. 0800 The Edge. What is the role reversal in your relationship? One of those weird things that he does or she does that she should do and he should do, but he does them because she doesn't do them.
P.S. Bryce, if you're listening, love you, babe. You're a sexy beast. My husband is nagging me about the laundry and how often he's cooking dinner, and I'm just like, shush, bitch, I just want to watch the sports show.
Don't call him a bitch.
I'm just kidding. I love you, babe. You're real...
I love how you say real harsh things and then you're like, oh no, he's going to divorce me. Quick, say I love you, babe. It'll make it all okay.
Yeah, that's what happens.
0800 The Edge, what is the role reversal in your relationship?
G'day, Grant. What's the role reversal in your relationship?
Well, basically she does everything apart from wiping my bum.
Really?
So
yeah.
Why don't you just...
mows the lawns. Well, I have a full-time job, so I work 40 hours a week, 45 hours a week.
It's not that many hours.
I don't mind mowing the lawns, but when I get home, they're all done for me, and washing my car, so I've got other things to do.
You sound very proud of this.
Yeah.
What was that?
You sound proud of it. If someone was... So say your house needed painting...
I'm very proud of her. She goes and does everything for me, mate. I mean, okay. I don't expect her to do it, but she does it for me. Yeah.
Good backtracking there, Grant. Good backtracking. In case you heard, you're still going to have your lawns mowed tonight.
I love that you talk about how busy you are, though. I work 40 to 45 hours a week. That's the minimum amount of work that someone can do for a full-time job.
To be honest, I had 5 months off work, too, because I broke my collarbone in karate at the start of the year. So
you're doing karate? You've got enough free time to do karate.
Grant,
all I'm hearing is excuses. Get home and mow those lawns.
Hey, come on, I rung up, didn't I?
Grant,
yeah,
you did.
Rain, by the way,
you are the man, Grant. Every guy that's listening right now going, Grant is the man.
Grant, you just had another excuse. You rang up even though it's raining.
You asked people to ring up, so I rang up.
Yeah, we appreciate the call, Grant. Thank you so much for calling. Get back to your busy life.
See you, Grant.
Yeah, cheers. I'm on my own there anyway. I start at 6 in the morning.
Oh, take it easy, bro. Take it easy.
I love him. He's awesome. Fenella, what does your husband do that's a bit of a role reversal?
He's my partner. He actually paints my fingernails and my toenails for me.
What? Aww. And it's not like a weird bedroom thing. He actually enjoys it?
No, he actually does. I'm like, can you pressure my nails? Because I cannot do them, especially the left hand. I'm really useless at it.
Does he do a good job? Is the big question.
He really does.
Or does he go over the lines? Okay. That's handy. He's a keeper then.
Definitely. And so in return, I... Help mow the lawns for him, so that's pretty cool.
Oh, yeah, I bet you do. Good on you. Good on you, Fenella.
Mow the lawns is not a euphemism, Sharyn.
Everything's a euphemism, Clint. Duncan, what's the role reversal in your relationship?
Oh, my girlfriend's a nurse, so she works late shifts, and so by the time she gets home, it's late at night and she's hungry, so I do all the cooking,
aww,
all the cleaning, all the laundry, so yeah, that's my role reversal.
Yeah, you sound like you should have a support group for whinging wives with my husband.
Hi, I'm Bryce, and I am the whinging wife. Bryce, you're a man. That's exactly what I'm talking about.
And finally, we are going to go to Chevy. Tell us about your role reversals.
Okay, I've got two.
Sorry, your name's Chevy, isn't it?
Yes.
Sorry, I do that to you every time I get your name wrong. Tell us about your role reversal.
My partner likes to sew. I don't even know how to operate a sewing machine. I don't even really know what one looks like. And the second one
is... It looks like a large machine with a needle on it and an engine at the other end.
Really? That's good to know.
It looks like a sewing machine.
Google it.
No, my partner also sulks after, we have sex in bed, so...
What does he sulk about?
Is he sulking because
I don't like to cuddle afterwards. It's all, hot and sticky and gross. Okay. So I'm like, no, can you just stay over there? And then he gets shit.
Chevy, you know we're doing a conversation on the radio right now. Everyone is hearing this.
Maybe her husband now will stop being such a pussy and just roll over and go to sleep.
Whoa!
It's okay. No, it's all right. He's out working. He's not listening right now.
They
it's
have
okay.
radios at work. You're screwed.
Next on the show, we get a visit from Pie Connoisseur Ross.
Guy, Sharyn and Clint on The Edge.
Time for a regular feature on the show that we call Pie Connoisseur Ross.
No, it's called Pie Connoisseur Ross.
Oh, shit.
It's called Pie Connoisseur Ross.
I was so impressed by my intro as well.
Because he is a pie connoisseur and his name is Ross.
Yeah.
It's
and then
clever.
We use a dinosaur pun.
Everyone gets it.
You didn't get it.
Play the sting.
No, I don't think we should play the sting just yet. I've got something to say.
You don't normally get to talk. You normally just say...
What's wrong, Ross?
You normally just say, it's beanie.
Well, that's when you gave me a beanie pie.
I thought you were talking about my dog thing, because I called my dog beanie, and I was like...
Oh, I was going to watch Sharyn bring it back to you.
Hey, let's focus on the pies, guys.
No, sorry. Ross wants to talk about it himself. What's up?
I've been a bit cranky today and yesterday.
Yeah.
I've gone on a health kick, which means no pies, no V, no...
Excuse me.
...other stuff.
Your name is Pie Connoisseur Ross. Like, yes. Pie is in the title of your name.
So what does that mean for Pie Connoisseur Ross?
What are you going to be now?
That's actually not my real name. That's just my pie name.
Bullshit. Show me your birth certificate.
I don't know where it is.
We're not going to call you Carrotsaurus Ross.
Yeah.
Well, I did have a lot of carrots.
No
today.
One's interested in a stupid kale review, mate.
Also,
I couldn't
Ross,
find kale at the supermarket, so I haven't done kale.
Clint
yet.
And I have known you for almost 10 years. We know for sure that by the time we do Pie Connoisseurus next year, you're not going to be doing this diet anymore.
Next week.
Yeah, next week.
Yeah, shall we just do this on Friday? Because that's when you'll be ready to eat the pie.
Well, the hard thing is, I noticed that you put a pie in front of me.
Play the intro. Let's get the Pie Connoisseurus fired up.
Legend tells of a great creature that roamed the plains, going from servo to servo in a quest to find the perfect pie. No mince and cheese spared, no bacon and egg neglected. Now, joining us live from the brink of extinction, the last of his kind, he is Pie Connoisseur Ross.
Okay. Did that get you to change your mind? Are you ready for a little nibble on the pie? Because the people want to know what this pie is like.
He's fiddling with his wedding ring because he knows if he cheats on his diet, his wife's going to be like,
"Oh, she was out drinking with you last night anyway, so it doesn't matter."
The Pie Connoisseurus man is coming back. Shove it in your gob, mate. You know you want to.
Just tell us what we've got first.
So we've got a Hollywood Bakery pie. I don't know which flavour, but it's clearly from the lovely ladies down at Hollywood Bakery Three Lamps.
It's your favourite mince and cheese.
Oh... It's like crack. Guys, I'm going to do it. This is for science.
He's going to do it.
And for New Zealand.
Okay.
Whee! I'm eating this pie. So good.
You made a sex face just then.
Connoisseur.
Totally worth it.
The Ross is back. The Pyconosaurus is back in the building, ladies. He's munching that pie. All right, slow down, mate. Slow down. You've been on a
Guy, Sharyn and Clint.
On the bloody edge.
Time for my Auntie Trish segment. Unfortunately, Auntie Trish, I said she was unwell last week. This week, she's died.
Oh.
She's gone. That was a bit dark, eh?
It's a good... If anyone can learn something from Auntie Trish, at least now they know that a cask of wine a night is not a good idea.
We've moved on. I don't know why I decided to take it such a dark place. I was just trying to get rid of reason for me killing off Auntie Trish. I don't know why I decided to go with her death, but anyway, I literally killed her off.
She moved to Ferndale. No one survives there.
And it's time for my weekly battle with popular music, because sometimes it's just a bit weird. This is Guy Williams's view on popular music. It's not catchy at all.
So bleak.
No.
Time now for Guy's Auntie Trish listens to popular music.
Oh, it's so loud. Can you turn it down a bit, please?
I like us better when we're wasted. It makes it easier to play.
Yeah, but it makes it much harder to write good songs.
I like us better when we're wasted.
I can't remember. Were we wasted when we wrote this crap? We've got to cut back on the drugs, eh?
She's nothing like a girl you've ever seen before. Nothing you can compare to your neighborhood.
Good. I wasn't going to compare her to that, but good. Excellent.
Trying to find the words to describe this girl without being disrespectful.
Beautiful, stunning.
The way that booty moving, I can't take no more. Have to stop what I'm doing so I can pull her close. I'm trying to find the words to describe this girl without being disrespectful.
Okay, don't want to be disrespectful. Cool, got it. What the f***?
She's a beast. I call her karma.
Okay.
She eats your heart out like Jeffrey Dahmer.
Jeffrey Dahmer, the murderer.
Be careful, try not to lead her on. Shawty heart is on steroids, cause her love is so strong.
Wait, did you just mention Jeffrey Dahmer?
You may fall in love when you meet her.
I gotta Google this.
Get the chance, you better keep her. She's sweet as pie, but if you break her heart, she turns cold as a freezer.
Wikipedia.com. Jeffrey Lionel Dahmer, also known as the Milwaukee Cannibal, was an American serial killer and sex offender who committed the rape, murder, and dismemberment of 17 men and boys between 1978 and 1991, with many of his later murders also involving necrophilia and cannibalism. How does that relate to Katy Perry again?
That was Guy's Auntie Trish listens to popular music.
That was really loud.
Thank you, Auntie Trish. She'll be on the podcast.
That was Guy.
Oh, thanks,
Too
Guy.
Too soon.
Thanks.
You know she
That's
just
okay.
died.
R.I.P. Auntie Trish.
Guy, Sharyn and Clint.
We had the most awkward moment, which created the first awkward silence at an Edge staff meeting on Monday. We were talking about Māori language.
Oh, not this again.
And we were saying how everyone needs to make an effort to make sure their pronunciation is good. But then Guy explained to all our special listener friends how you silenced a room of people that are impossible to shut up.
Do you ever think like you've got like a great joke and it can either go two ways? It can either bring the house down in a good way, like everyone laughs,
yeah,
or bring the house down in a way like you killed it. Quit your job now. You're a loser. Please leave the premises. We never want to talk to you again.
Yeah. Most people listening understand that completely because they listen to our show a lot.
This went the bad way, where it was death silence. Basically, the observation I had when we were talking about Māori Language Week was that I thought it was hilarious, and I said it this loudly. Oh, my God. I just realised the Edge doesn't have any brown people. The Edge is racist. And I thought everyone would laugh at this observation. Dead silence. Crickets. And then all of a sudden, Mike Pudu just goes, hey, what about me? And he's like, he's the nicest guy, so he was cool about it, but I cleared the room. I created the ultimate awkward silence.
Mike was not cool. He was really awkward about it.
No, Mike's a lovely guy, and he was completely sweet with it. And
I'm pretty sure he wasn't sweet with it.
It's Māori Language Week, mate. Everyone's just like glad to talk about Māori Language Week and glad that we've got a Māori at the edge.
We've got Mike on the phone right now. Let's find out how awkward Mike did feel. Welcome to the show, Mr. Mike Puru. How do you feel about the awkward silence at our staff meeting yesterday?
Well, I know what Guy is describing, that awkward silence after a joke. It happens quite a bit at some of his comedy gigs.
Come on, Mike, that was unnecessary.
I know, I left, although I was silent at the time. I was just running through my head, and I thought, does he think I'm Asian? Does he, does what is going on here? Am I invisible to the man? You know, does he not know that I work here? Has he not realised I'm a Māori fella?
Mike, are you the leader of the Edge Kapa Haka team? And the only member as well, with Clint in the background backing you up? Sharyn on the poise?
No, I do. I'm from Southland, and it was hard to be a Māori in Southland because there was only about seven of us. So, the further north I got, the more respected I thought I would have been. And in my own whānau, in my own family at the edge, I thought I would have been way more respected, Guy, but nah.
Well,
you just shot me down. And I know what you were trying to do. I just, it was very awkward.
We had your back, Mike, and we're very sorry about Guy.
Mike, I am very sorry. Okay. I don't know the Māori word for sorry, but I would say that right now if I could.
Okay, no, I accept your apology because it is Māori Language Week. Aroha te reo. There you go. Love our language.
That is so cute.
Beautiful.
Mike, thank you so much for joining us. We want to hear this afternoon about when you have created an awkward silence in your workplace or just in your life in general. When have you bought up the crickets?
I got so many more examples of this. I do this like pretty much every day.
Stephen, what was yours?
It wasn't me, it was one of my colleagues, but we were in a meeting with one of our big clients, and one of the ladies there was pregnant, and he decided to say that she gets drunk too much and she wouldn't know who the father was, and that it could possibly be the CEO.
Damn!
Oh.
That is definitely extremely awkward. I would have uppercutted a man if they could.
Yeah, that's a combination of crickets and throw a stapler at someone's head.
Rachel, tell us your story.
Hi, we were having Friday night drinks in one of the offices when I was in Dunedin, and we had a few, and I said to the person next to me, I said, who's that? And she goes, it's the boss's wife. And I said, but what about the blonde that he was with last week all over?
Damn! Oh! Gold!
That would have gone down like a cup of cold sick.
That would teach him, though. That would definitely teach him. If he's going to cheat on his wife, then amen to that girl. I'd high five her. That's what I'd do. 0800 at the edge. Chelsea, tell us about the awkward silence that you created.
So, basically, I was sitting in a bar and a guy leaned over. I'd recently cut my hair short, and I was getting lesbian and boy comments all the time, and it was just driving me bonkers. So this guy leaned over. He was probably drunk as anything, and leans over and goes, "Oh, you look like a dude." And I turned around and went, "I had cancer."
Oh! And did the whole bar just go quiet?
Yeah, I didn't have cancer, and I feel terrible.
Oh, that's terrible!
I feel absolutely terrible, but you know what? That guy will never say anything nasty like that again, will he?
You did shut him up, so I reckon that was all right. I think you did well there.
It's a great area.
Karma doesn't eat me.
There's not many comebacks to a cancer call, is there?
No, exactly.
And the look on his face was just like, oh, my God, and everyone in the bar was absolutely silent, and then it was... Yeah, dude, that's not cool.
Yeah.
Don't say that again. Terrible excuse. But we couldn't have done this we couldn't have done this phone topic without talking to our mate Stephen, because Stephen! Stephen!
From Palmerston North.
He most definitely would have had one of these. Stephen, tell us what happened to you.
Awkward. Okay, there it is. So, I'm in the tea room having a chat to someone about a guy that I was, seeing. Anyway, this
Hang on, Stephen.
What?
Are you gay?
Breaking news. Breaking news, guys. I'm a homosexual male.
Whoa. No, I'm just kidding. Carry on with your story.
That is not awkward. It's 2014. Anywho, so I'm in the tea room. That sounds great, tea room. And I'm talking to my friend about a gay scenario that I've encountered. Anyway, that sounds awkward. And then the nosy lady comes into the room and she overlistens to me. And I said, nah, I'm not going to have it. So she comes in with a comment. She said, oh, what's his name? And I turned around and I said, excuse me. Just because I talk with a flamboyant accent, you think I take up the ring-a-danger? How very, very dare you?
Oh!
The room went silent, and it was really awkward.
But just for the record, you are gay, though, eh?
Pretty gay, ring-a-danger all the way.
Bye, Stephen. God, I love him.
Stephen!
It turns out that you're not the only one, guys, so it's good to know.
Guy, Sharyn and Clint.
On the bloody edge.
All this week and next week, thanks to BNZ, we've got a whole lot of money to give away. Like $35,000 to give away on a BNZ U-Money card to spend on whatever you want. So you tell us at theedge.co.nz.
On whatever you want?
On whatever you want. On whatever you need, really. Well, the idea is you tell us what you're in need of money for at the moment.
I need a samurai sword.
Well, you could tell us that. If you wanted a samurai sword and you needed money for it.
Yeah, I do.
And you told us that at theedge.co.nz.
Yeah.
We could do that for you.
You're going to get me a samurai sword?
No, we would give you a BNZ low-rate MasterCard if you were the one that got chosen.
I'm waiting for you to say samurai sword's a bad idea, but you're not saying it, so it's great. I'm going to get a samurai sword.
You're welcome to enter, as always saying. Now, we've had a whole lot of these entries at theedge.co.nz, and our intern, Mon, has been sifting through these entries. From there, she's picked out some of the best ones, and we've sent her into the studio to dramatically recreate one of our favourites today. Here is the person we're giving money to.
I have recently started participating in a new hobby. Full contact medieval combat.
My name is Sir Mark. And I'm fighting Sir Mark.
Unfortunately, it's quite expensive to own or even purchase the equipment, e.g. the actual armour, and I just can't seem to save enough. I thought I might see if you guys can help me out, as I want to be ready for next year's big event in Jan. It will take place at the Harcourt Park in Upper Hutt on the 20th. Hopefully, if I get all the armour ready, I can participate in my first full contact tournament. It's so big that it's international. And then if I do well, I hope to make the New Zealand team. The Steel Blacks. That's what I'm calling them anyway. So please, please help me out. Help me become a fully fledged knight in shining armour.
I think it's time that we made this in particular dream come true. We've got Mark on the phone. Mark, how did you feel hearing your letter recreated?
That was actually really awesome.
So you're really into this whole, like, Mortal Kombat thing?
Yeah, well, I wasn't at first. You know, it sounded a bit weird, but, I mean, after the first training session, I was hooked from there.
That is so cool.
It's medieval combat, though,
medieval,
not Mortal Kombat.
Sorry.
He's not going out there going, "A dog it!" Because I'm pretty sure you can do that for free.
That would be awesome, too.
That would be awesome.
I got that part wrong.
So what do you, Mark, what sort of equipment do you need? Like a big-ass samurai sword or something?
Not a samurai sword.
All the equipment has to be correct to the period that you're wanting it from. Like, let's say the 13th or 14th century.
Yeah.
So everything has to be as accurate as possible.
Wow.
Can you get like a bomby knocker, like a stick with like a ball with spikes on the end?
There's some nice weapons in the arsenal, I have to admit.
Sick. You
know, like long swords. A lot of the people love the long swords.
Mark, do you need a horse?
No, not for this particular tournament.
Good, because we can't afford a horse, but...
We are going to hook you up with $500 on a BNZ low-rate MasterCard, all right? So you can enjoy that.
Awesome. That's going to help me so much. Thank you guys very much.
No worries at all. And don't forget, the BNZ low-rate MasterCard offers 0% interest on purchases for 6 months. So get all the details at theedge.co.nz.
From that, tell us what you need some money for, and we could give you money for it. Does it make sense now?
Yeah, he should get some jousting sticks.
Oh, God.
Oh, no, needs a horse for that.
Guy, Sharyn and Clint.
On the edge.
We've got a special guest on the show this afternoon.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the show, all the way from the Mission District of the San Francisco of California, star of Mythbusters, the TV show, and he's coming to New Zealand, the wonderful, the amazing Adam Savage.
Hey!
Look, there it is.
Well, that's the best
I've ever gotten.
Oh, wow. Thank you very much.
It's what we do here, Adam. It's what we do. You guys are heading to New Zealand to do some shows. We're quite excited. 6th of September at Vector Arena.
I don't want to grill you here and put you on the spot, but I was reading in your bio that you worked on Star Wars Episode 1.
Yes, I'm sorry about that.
Are you... I hadn't even got to my grilling yet. I was going to say, are you responsible for Jar Jar Binks?
Oh, God, no. you know, it's funny when you work at, you can't choose the movies that you work on. So when I worked in special effects, I didn't work on a single movie that I love. I mean, I worked on the Star Wars Episode 1 and 2 and The Matrix 2 and 3. And
oh, no.
Are you okay saying this on air? Because I feel like if this word gets back to the people who made the films, you may never work in film again.
Well, you know, I found this other career in television that's pretty good.
Oh, yeah. Stop bragging about it.
Yeah, he's doing all right.
Every movie you touch turns to crap.
Maybe you could do the special effects in Sex and the City 3. That'll be a good movie.
I want nothing to do with that terrible movie.
Oh, wash your mouth out. Well, thank you so much.
Oh, no. I have seen all of the Sex and the City shows, but that movie is genuinely awful.
Oh, you almost won me over. I'm not even going to make a Gilmore Girls reference because I feel like you're just going to break my heart all over again. Well, you guys are coming to New Zealand. You're going to be doing a show at Vector Arena on September the 6th. We can't wait to have you here in New Zealand. So what are you looking forward to about seeing us?
Oh, my goodness. I've always wanted to come down there, and we're actually coming in a few days early. I think my wife and I are going to rent a car and drive around for a few days. I know I want to get down to Wellington to see some friends of mine over at Weta.
Awesome.
Oh, name drop that. Just go check out Peter Jackson.
Exactly. And besides that, I've heard tell that New Zealand is the most beautiful place on earth, and that if I go there, I'm going to want to move there. So I look forward to feeling like that.
Nah, it's a myth. It's rubbish.
Well, I'm going to be honest with you. All that stuff in Lord of the Rings is all CGI. It's actually terrible here. I wouldn't even bother coming.
Yeah, Peter Jackson, also not actually a real person, created in Weta Workshop.
Oh, brilliant, brilliant. Yeah. See, because I heard that all those locations were like 10 minutes from where the office was.
Yeah, myth.
Ladies and gentlemen, he's coming to New Zealand to do a live show. That was Adam Savage!
Join us later in the show as well when Adam Savage from Mythbusters co-hosts a special edition of Uber Facts.
It's going to be amazing. Actually, I already know it's going to be amazing, so trust me on that.
Guy, Sharyn and Clint on The Edge.
Sharyn, we're just going to have to delay the conversation about Gorgeous Mike for a minute.
Oh, no. I'm in a bit of trouble, guys.
Yeah, so.
It's time to spin the How Does It Feel wheel!
When you're alone and you're cold inside, like a stranger in Moscow.
Every week, we try and find out how something different feels, and then we bring you that experience on the radio so that hopefully you never have to go through it and you never have to go, oh, now I don't have to pee on that electric fence, or, oh, now I don't have to run through that wheel, through that wall.
It's like almost a consumer kind of service that we do. It's lovely that we do this, and people can just listen to the show and just find out firsthand that things suck.
Like a dysfunctional family health diaries. The ringmaster of this catastrophe is Senor Chang. Hello, Chang.
Hello. Today, this week's one will be interesting to see what happens.
What are we doing?
It's how does it feel to be pepper sprayed? Oh. And this is not a, like, police-issued pepper spray. This is a homemade one because we cannot buy. It's illegal for us to buy it. So we have to make one.
So how does it feel to get homemade pepper sprayed?
Yeah.
Who's making the pepper spray?
I think we'll leave it to intern Mon to make it.
All right, she's going to whip up. Mon, second week on the job, time to make some pepper spray.
Hold on a minute. You say it's illegal to buy it. Is it not illegal to, like, brew it up in your
No, no, no. It's okay to...
That's why he's getting you to do it.
It's okay to make your own, but not to buy it.
But like, if it lands on me, I'm not going to make a horrible one for myself.
We'll get Chang to make your one. I'm nervous about this because I've spent, like, $6,000 getting my eyes lasered. What if this makes me blind?
Jesus, what's wrong with your eyes?
Oh, what is it?
Nothing anymore. She spent $6,000 on them.
I know. Okay. We'll finish.
How is Mon supposed to know how to make pepper spray?
There is a step-by-step instruction. There's a six-step instruction that I sent her.
It's
that
on
I found on Google.
It's on a cool website called alqaeda.com.
Oh.
Check it out. Oh. Oh, is it? on? Why was it on?
Always
turn it's on. It's a terrorist organisation. They'd be proud if they heard it. Am I offending members of Al-Qaeda who might be listening to our show?
Good terrorism joke, guy.
If you get a fruit basket or something from them, I don't want any of it.
An Al-Qaeda
I don't
want to
get my
basket.
Face blown up.
Okay, I'm dubious about this. Hugely dubious about this homemade pepper spray job. But in the name of science, are you sure we can't get police pepper spray?
No, I've tried the police.
What
you're
about
not
just personal safety pepper
you,
spray?
You can't buy. You can't
what about just
anyway?
Like a pepper grinder? Just sprinkle a little bit.
That's
on
not the same.
Are you sure that we can't just do? How does it feel to get a massage from Gorgeous Mike?
Let's spin the wheel. No. Let's do this.
Here we go.
Please not me.
It better not be me because I'm going to have to do my first read. Thank God!
It's Gary Williams!
Jeepers, and what's best about this is that after this we've got to go drive go-karts for charity. It's going to be, how does it feel to have a full frontal collision on a go-kart?
Maybe you could have a re-spin and hopefully it lands on Chang or Mon.
I'm screwed.
I thought that was going to be on me for a second there. I was like, oh,
it was very close.
The man who already wears milk bottle glasses and can't see 3 feet in front of him. Tomorrow, we'll find out how it feels to be pepper sprayed with homemade pepper spray.
Guy, Sharyn and Clint. Itch.
Things are a bit awkward, guys. I think I might have to sleep here tonight. Should I try to ring him one more time?
Is this Bryce?
This is my husband.
Give it an attempt.
How many times have you called him now and he hasn't answered?
14.
14.
That's not far off. I've been watching her.
I've been trying to, and I left a message. I was like, hey, boo, it's me. Call me back. Love you.
If you've just joined us, Sharon's having some relationship problems.
My husband doesn't love me anymore.
Well, no, I'm sure he's all right with you. It's just that you're in love with a guy that he works with.
We've got trouble. He's not picking up. This is real trouble.
Hang on.
Oh, no. Hang on. Sometimes he takes a while.
Kia ora, Bryce here.
No, that's just him pretending he's Māori.
Nice putting kia ora on for Māori Language Week.
Yeah, no.
Tell us about it, Sharyn.
Things got a bit awkward last night. Because yesterday we were talking about Clint's hot flatmate, Gorgeous Mike, who looks a little bit like Taylor Lautner. And I then didn't think that Bryce was listening to the show, and he texted me and he said, settle down, mate. And I thought, ha 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 ha, he's having a little laugh with me.
Yeah.
So I text back, lol. Then last night I went and I got a photo of Gorgeous Mike at work yesterday because he works next door at The Rock. And I put it on our Facebook page for all the...
Wait. When you say you got a photo, did you sneak up under his desk and go, hey, and then take a photo real quick?
No, I just walked through and I went,
hey.
Hey, Mike! And he would turn around with his gorgeous smile, model ready at all times. Bang, got a photo. Put it on our Instagram, put it on our Facebook.
Isn't that legal?
Just so that people knew who Gorgeous Mike was, who we were talking about, put a gorgeous face to the name, all that sort of stuff.
Okay.
Husband got quite upset about it. I said, I'm not touching, just looking and sharing it with fellow female listeners that
as
would
you
appreciate.
And male listeners.
And male listeners, they would appreciate it.
As a semi-straight man, I can honestly say that he is a very good-looking dude. And I can imagine he's listening to us right now being incredibly weirded out by this conversation.
I was just doing a public service for the listeners of this radio show.
Gorgeous Mike got nearly 400 likes on our Facebook page
And he looked
night.
Great under a filter on Instagram as well.
Sarah Smeet said, ooh, I see what you mean, Sharyn. Someone said, thanks, Sharyn. Someone said, Sharyn, you have fantastic taste in men.
Thank you.
Did Bryce comment?
Jana said, thank you, Sharyn. Thank you.
See, I'm just doing a public service. It is no different from the hot girls that my husband posts on his work Facebook page.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, get a load of these tits. You know? I'm not doing that. But he got a little bit angry, and we tried to get him on the show to talk about it today because I walked through their work today, and everyone, including their boss, came out, and they're like, oh, cut it out with the sexual harassment on Mike. And I was like, whoa. He's a young single guy. He deserves to be praised by the female population of New Zealand.
He deserves it. He's earned the right.
He deserves to be treated like a piece of meat.
He's been working so hard, and I'm just saying, don't turn up when you've just been in the gym all sweaty if you don't want us to sexually harass you in the workplace.
He's also excellent at basketball, by the way.
You're saying that he's asking for it.
I didn't say that. Those were your words, not mine, Clint. I will be either here late tonight or I'm going to have to go home and really put some work in.
Guy, Sharyn and Clint. On the Bloody Edge.
With BNZ this week, we're trying to find out what you need some money for. You just tell us what life's thrown at you, and from there, we will choose some cool stories to give some money to, thanks to the BNZ Low Rate MasterCard.
Earlier in the show, we gave someone $500 to go towards their what is it called?
Medieval fighting competition in Lower Hutt.
Looking back on it, wasn't the smartest way to spend some cash. But send in an interesting story, or like a kind of something a little bit quirky, and we'll be into it. Plus, we're recreating the emails in kind of a funky way.
Yeah, our intern Mon has sifted through all the emails we've received so far, and this is one of our favourites.
I am hairy like a Sasquatch. And I hate it. I would like to get laser hair removal. I am light-skinned and my hair is dark. I am a girl. I am not supposed to have a beard and a mo. It's gross and I'm over it. Plus, I have the dreaded monobrow. Plucking is laborious and it's painful and I'm totally over it.
By the way, the Sasquatch was played by Sharyn.
I did that and they put an effect on me. I did a great job, but enough about me. Let's bring Polly on. Hey, Polly.
Hi.
Polly, you Sasquatch. How are you doing?
Hairy today.
Same as every day.
How often are you having to take care of your hair situation? Is it a daily battle or do you...
Yeah, it's every day, a couple of times a day.
Wow.
Couple of times a day?
Yeah.
When you say you shouldn't have a beard, do you really have a beard? Like, at the end of the day, do you have a 5 o'clock shadow?
Well, no, but it's little bits here and there. God, this is embarrassing.
Well, you know what?
Sorry.
We won't ask you too many more questions, Polly.
Sorry for emailing into a radio station.
I know. I was desperate.
We won't ask any more questions, Polly. And as a girl, I know that these sorts of things are really, really annoying. So what we're going to do is we are going to hook you up with $500 on a BNZ low-rate MasterCard, and you can go and get laser hair removal, do whatever you want, but that's all for you to help your Sasquatch situation.
Oh, my gosh. Thank you so much.
No worries at all.
One more thing before you go. Have you ever entered Movember?
No, but I might win if I did.
Don't be mean. Good luck with it all, Polly. You're going to look babing real soon.
Thank you.
And the BNZ Low Rate MasterCard is for whatever life throws at you. Get all the details now, theedge.co.nz.
And submit your story, because tomorrow we could give that money to you.
Guy, Sharyn and Clint.
On the Edge.
Forget what you're doing, because it's no better than what you're going to be doing right now. Here it is for this week, the very special edition of Uber Fact.
You know what time it is! You're about to get Uber Facted in the face!
No, she did it!
Oh, yes, she did!
This is Uber Fact special edition with special guest Adam Savage from Mythbusters!
Hey.
So good to have you here, Adam. Let's get straight into it. First Uber Fact of the week. Cockroaches feel exactly the same way about us as we do about them. So if a person touches them, they run away, they hide in their little house, they get in the little cockroach bath, and they wash themselves.
I'm going to say that's totally true.
Yes! Welcome! Well, it's about time I had someone that believed in me on Uber Facts.
I don't want to argue with Adam,
you.
So I'm going to give him that.
I would just squash the little piece of crap and get on with my day. Next one. Cuddling and other acts of love. I'm talking about sex, guys, in case you didn't pick up on that.
Okay, got ya.
That can actually help heal physical wounds faster because it releases oxytocin in your body.
Wow.
But I'm going to say that that's true because I want it to be true, and it's good for everyone if they all believe that it's true.
Yes!
Adam, you're putting your scientific credentials on the line here by agreeing to all these Uber facts.
I will tell you, that's the best part. I have no scientific credentials whatsoever.
don't say that. You're making my segment credible. All right, let's get on to the next one. Under extremely high pressure, peanut butter, that delicious little spread that you can get in crunchy or smoothie, you put it all over your toes and you put it all over your face and wherever else you want to put it. You can actually turn that into diamonds if you put it under extremely high pressure.
Well, it's an organic compound, which means it has a bunch of carbon in it, and a diamond is made of carbon, so I believe that would be true of almost any food or living object.
My God!
How does it feel to be wrong? Everybody else but me and Adam. Next one. This is a very intense, Adam, so just pretend you're an octopus. When mating...
This is very intense.
Adam,
pretend you're an octopus.
Yeah, are you pretending, Adam?
Okay.
Okay. When mating, the male octopus tears off his arm, which is also the arm that's also his diddle, places it in the female, and then swims off and dies.
No, I don't believe that that's true at all.
Thank God.
It's
finally
true.
Thank God.
That's why there's so many octopuses under the sea. And when they did that in The Little Mermaid, when Sebastian was singing, under the sea, under the sea, under the sea, see any octopuses? No, you didn't. Because they had already got rid of their penis arms and got off to die somewhere.
No, next one, one more. Let's wrap this up.
The final one, more of a fun fact than an urban fact for everybody. Throughout the entire Twilight saga, all three movies, there is over 24 minutes of just staring at each other.
Really, it's only 24 minutes? Because it seems like a lot more than that.
Only 24 minutes, Adam. And that has been Urban Facts. Thank you so much for being a special guest and giving my segment credibility.
That was Urban Facts with Adam Savage, ladies and gentlemen.
Adam will be here for Mythbusters. It's happening live at Victor Arena in Auckland this September, and you can find all the Mythbusters details online now at theedge.co.nz. Adam, thanks.
Woo-hoo! Thanks so much for having me, guys. Have a great day.
Hey, Adam, before you go, could you just admit and just say, I'm Adam Savage, and I just got uber-facted in the face.
I'm Adam Savage, and I just got uber-facted in the face.
Hot damn, that's an uber-fact.
Hot damn, that was the best part of my day.
Guy, Sharyn, and Clint.
On the Edge.
Something's been really, really grinding my gears, guys. It's been really doing my head in. I've been going out, because every couple of months, my husband and I, we reward ourselves by going to the mall and we buy outfits.
What are you rewarding yourself for?
For working and working hard for our money.
Okay. Are you working hard right now?
We pay, yeah, so hard.
Do you buy matching outfits?
No, we just go and buy outfits and we go out for dinner or something. It's just a thing that we do to reward ourselves because we, you know, pay a mortgage and stuff. It's just something
okay. We
like to do together. But it's really frustrating because I've got a massive sneaker collection now because I can't find a top. And it's really frustrating because I'll go and I'm like, oh, I'm just going to go find a nice top.
Yeah.
Every nice top that I find is a frickin' crop top. I want to burn a bonfire of crop tops. Now, I just want to put it out there. Crop tops look beautiful on younger girls that have not got their curves yet. And also girls that work really hard at the gym and have amazing bodies. And I see them in crop tops and I'm like, oh, power to you, girl. If I look like that, I'll wear a crop top every day. But there's a lot of girls in New Zealand that can't wear crop tops. And all the cool tops are crop tops.
Very interesting, Sharyn. I'm listening to what you're saying. Big fan of girls that go to the gym and work very hard. Very, very big fan of curvy girls as well. And I'm loving everything you're saying. My one problem with the crop top discussion is that I don't know what a crop top is.
Okay, so a crop top is, if you don't know, it's like the short t-shirts that finish around about the belly button.
Because
and sometimes they have beads hanging off them.
Yeah.
A Britney Spears top.
Kind of, yeah. Or they finish before you get to your jeans. So as soon as you sit down, and unless you're like super, got an amazing body.
Yeah.
As soon as you sit down, your stomach kind of like rolls together. Even if you don't have a massive stomach, it's just a fact of life.
And
it happens.
And when you go to the mall, you always see females, and also sometimes males. Sometimes males have singlets that just don't quite fit, who are just not nailing it at all, and they just do not have the body to pull it off, and they're just like hanging out there.
And you get cold kidneys.
Just not warm.
I just can't do the crop top because I'm curvy. I'm not.
No one can.
I'm not massively overweight. I'm probably a little bit bigger than what I should be, but crop tops are the every single. I went to one shop. Every single top was a crop top.
Oh, that's BS,
all
mate.
All I wanted was a nice top that would sit at the top of my jeans that showed a little bit of cleave.
I reckon that the hardest part of your body is got to be just above the belt, around the middle. That's going to be the toughest part, and that's the bit that the crop top exposes.
Yes,
it's going for the wrong part. So that's why, just in my mind, just then, I designed a new type of top for women or for men. Fashion-conscious men could be into this as well. Basically, how it works is you have like a normal, like kind of bikini top. Then you expose a little bit of the bit under the breast because that's always easy to keep in shape.
Yes, mm-hmm. I'm okay with showing a little bit of sternum. Sternum.
Yeah, get a bit of sternum in there, and then over the belly, material again. Okay.
Yeah.
This is a new thing. I call it the kind of the hamburger top, because you've got your top bun, your bottom bun, and then in the middle is like the meat.
I would wear that, because yeah. My waist small until I get to my hips, and then it's like, girl, one day we're going to put a baby out of there.
If anybody out there would like to join us in designing the first hamburger top, please get in touch. Email guy@theedge.co.nz.
Call me Glassons, I'm ready to go.
I'm just saying, hashtag I hate crop tops. But if you look good in one, high five to you, you look good.
Preach it, sister.
Guy, Sharyn and Clint.
On the Edge. Bit of show feedback from my dad, Gazza Williams.
Oh, God.
Gary. He said...
Is it more compliments for Chang?
He does love Chang. He loves Chang and all his money-saving tips that Gary... That we take on as a piss take, and Gary takes very seriously, like he's taking notes.
Yeah.
Now, my dad was like, hey, Guy, did you realise that like a lot of your listeners, when you're in the afternoon, are like driving home from work in their cars? And I was like...
Oh, my God.
I was like, Dad, we're called The Drive Show. That's the main reason we do it at this time.
Yeah.
So a lot of people are driving. It did make me think. We've got to talk about driving a little bit more often.
Okay.
And I got a pet peeve to bring to the table. It's those signs that I think are designed for road safety, but I think are making the roads a lot less safe.
Okay.
I don't know if they have them everywhere, but they definitely had them where I grew up in Nelson, and we have them here in Auckland. They're the Your Speed signs.
Oh, the digital ones, and it tells you what you said. There's one by your house, Sharyn.
No, there's
on Oniwa Road.
There's specifically just an Auckland and Nelson thing. No other place in New Zealand has them.
Are you taking the piss?
Yes.
Okay.
That everywhere.
Well, you never know. I don't know. We can... Can everywhere afford them? I don't know. They're quite flash. Anyway, I'm excited when I see them, and I see the number like flashing over,
yeah.
And I'm so excited to find out what my speed is.
Yeah,
and I'm like, I want to find out what the speed is, but it's flicking over so quickly that I can't tell. It's like 49, 47, 51, 32, 29, 67, 40 sign, and I'm staring at that
40 sign.
I'm staring at the sign, trying to figure out. This is how confused I am. I almost crashed my car while trying to find out what my speed is.
Two things.
Yeah.
They quite often have them when there's two lanes of traffic going in the same direction. And if you're side by side with a car, whose speed is it reading?
That's a shambles.
Second, there's a little thing just in front of your steering wheel called a speedo that tells you how fast you're going.
Yeah, you kind of bummed me out there with your theorem.
So, hey, Guy, do you want some ice to that sweet burn from Clint?
You bummed me out there. But still, I want the sign to tell me. I want to know how accurate that is. And you can't find out. I honestly think that number, that random number machine, which is what I think it is. I don't even think it even is telling the time. Because sometimes I'm the only car on the... It's the middle of the night. I'm the only car on the road. And it's still going 47, 32, 51, 6. It's mental.
It's also because you're moving. It's hard to measure something that's moving.
Well, no, that is the sole purpose of a speedometer.
Yeah, well, maybe
is to measure something that's moving.
Maybe it's the sign's first day.
Two.
And it's still learning, and you're just giving it a really hard time.
Okay, just briefly want to touch on this for driving complaints as well. Two other signs that are peeving me off at the moment.
Okay.
One I'm seeing a lot, slippery... it's got the car slipping over.
Oh, you know yes. That? Yes.
And it says when icy.
Yes.
And I'm like, no crap, ice is slippery.
No, and do you know what's even more annoying than that?
What?
And this OCD people out there will understand this, and I've had this problem forever.
Is this the tracks?
The tracks of the wheels cross over.
Oh, my God.
There is not a physical way that a car could cross its wheels over like that. It's never going to happen,
hang on, it's not realistic.
Hang on.
How do you know what a cartoon car is capable of?
Yeah. Hey,
it's a cartoon car. You guys are being real mean to these signs.
I've figured it out, guys. I've figured out what the car did. It drove... You know how cars can sometimes go up on two wheels?
Yeah.
So it goes up on its side. The person who was driving that cartoon car went up on two wheels, did the first track... looked back around, and then did the second track on the other two wheels.
Well, surely that would have been extra hard if it was slippery.
Well, it was slippery, so that's why it happened.
And by the way, slippery when icy, no crap, everything is slippery when icy.
Yeah.
You may as well just turn that sign into, I sucks, bro, try not to die.
Anything else? I feel like we've just had a big vent for 20 minutes.
Oh, it's been a good vent.
Crop tops.
It's been good.
Road signs.
We've got a lot of problems in this world, and these are the big ones. Crop tops and road signs.
You don't know what, though?
What?
Damn it, I forgot the words that Ariana Grande
song. One less problem without you. I got one less problem.
I never problem.
Guy, Sharyn and Clint on the Bloody Edge.
Thank you, everybody, for joining us on today's podcast.
I've just designed a new dress. It's like a burqa, but it shows a little bit of the waist, like the hamburger top that Guy was talking about. Because then I can work my assets, my eyes, my titties and my waist.
Okay. Hang on, you're okay. Cutting the titties out of the burqa as well.
No, hang on, I need to get some cleave in there. So cleave, waist, the rest is there.
So it's like a burqa. It's like a religious garment, but you've cut off little windows so people can see, like, your assets.
Yeah, my titties, my waist.
What okay. About put a bit of leg in there as well? Like some bit of upper thigh?
No, because I don't have box.
That is exactly what the opposite of a burqa is for.
It's the atheist burqa.
We'll market it in Iran. It's going to be big in Iran. Fashion summer 2014.
There's going to be two fruit baskets.
Thank you for joining us. We'll be back tomorrow.
The Guy, Sharyn and Clint podcast. Yeah.